Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. Would you like to experience smoother skin, fewer wrinkles, and increased muscle mass? How about reduced appetite, increased libido, and deeper sleep with vivid dreams? It all starts with repopulating your microbiome with the right kind of probiotics, specifically Lactobacillus reuteri. And thanks to the work of one pioneering cardiologist, we're learning more and more about how to dramatically improve our gut health, sleep, and even our outlook on life. If you're worried about cholesterol, this show is for you. Our friend, the brilliant Dr. William Davis, is back, challenging us with this question. After 50 years of obsessing over cholesterol and saturated fat and handing out statins like Tic Tacs, are we really that much healthier? Perhaps it's time to try something different. As longtime listeners know, Dr. William Davis is a cardiologist, number one New York Times best-selling author, and health crusader whose best-selling books include the Wheat Belly series, Undoctored, Super Gut, and many more. Before we get to the interview, if you'd like to make sure that this free show keeps coming your way, please visit us at fatburningman.com. You can find over 500 episodes of this show in video, audio, and full transcript, as well as if you sign up for our newsletter, then I'll send you a free quick start guide and many tasty recipes to make sure that you get started on the right foot. And of course, if you're listening to this podcast or watching it somewhere and you haven't already clicked subscribe, please hit that subscribe button. Click like, leave a comment. Even better, leave us a review. It helps more people find this show. I really, really appreciate it. All right, on to this show with Dr. Davis. You're about to learn why the medical establishment wasted 50 plus years obsessing over cholesterol and saturated fat, and why we should avoid wheat and grains instead. Why you can't out-exercise a bad diet. How to repopulate your microbiome with good bacteria. How to improve skin health, reduce wrinkles, and rebuild cartilage in your knees and hips. Why we should be eating the fat as well as more organ meats, how to save money by making bone broth and ferments from scratch at home, what to look forward to in the future of health, and tons more. Let's go hang out with Dr. William Davis. Welcome back, folks. Today we're here once again with one of our very favorite doctors in the whole world. Dr. William Davis is a cardiologist, number one New York Times bestselling author, and health crusader whose bestselling books include the Wheat Belly series, Undoctored, Super Gut, and many more. Thank you so much for joining us once again, Dr. Davis.
Glad to be back, Abel.
So I was just looking at our first interview together when I had you on the show back in 2012, and I think this is your fifth appearance on this show, which might now set the record for the most of anyone, which I'm very much honored to have you back. I'm sincere when I say that. But we were just catching up a little bit before we started here about how much the world has changed, especially the world of health and the internet and all the rest of it in the past few years. I'm so grateful that you're out there working on so many projects. And I've heard you talk recently about the benefits of being curious in general, especially as it relates to your health. So maybe we can start right there.
Exactly right. You know, I see this among my colleagues that something happens to them and the majority of them, I'm generalizing, of course, but the majority of them seem to lose curiosity. And so when a smart guy like you or your listeners come with a new idea or question, they tend to dismiss you. Oh, Abel, did you consult Dr. Google again? Oh, there's something wrong with you. There's no curiosity. And it really got driven home several times when, way back when, I think I told this story to you before, but it's a great example of how the doctor was not curious. It was a 38-year-old school teacher, and I was seeing her for a relatively minor cardiac question, and it turned out to be nothing. Flip-flops or palpitations. And she tested negative for all important things. So I just kind of comforted her. I said, you know, don't let it bother you, blah, blah, blah. But she's holding her abdomen the whole time in pain. And I said, you know, are you okay? What's going on? She says, well, it's my ulcerative colitis. I've had it for 12 years. I'm in constant pain, diarrhea all the time, and I'm bleeding. And I have to get a transfusion every 2 or 3 months. I said, you know, you're here just for this palpitation. So you and I haven't gotten into diet. Let's do that. I told her what I did with the rest of my patients, that is wheat and grain elimination, et cetera. And she says, oh, no. They biopsied me twice for celiac disease. And they tested all the blood. But I'm negative. I said, I get that. I'm not talking about celiac disease. I'm talking about other problems like your ulcerative colitis. So they were planning to take her colon out in a few weeks. So I said, you know, what do you have to lose? They're going to take your colon out. You know, if you take a colon out in a young woman, she's got to wear an ileostomy bag, at least for a long time, if not for the rest of her life. And if you've seen one of these things, they're awful. They smell, they make all kinds of weird sounds, and it's the end of your sex life, right?
Sure.
So she says, oh, okay. And she does it. Well, she comes back some weeks later, happy. She hops up on the table. And I said, tell me what happened. She said, well, I did it. One, I lost 38 pounds, and you didn't even tell me I'd lose weight. So she lost 38 pounds without trying. And she says, within 5 days, all the diarrhea and pain and bleeding stopped. I felt so good. I stopped one of the drugs. A couple more weeks, I'm feeling so good. Best ever in years. I stopped the second drug. And then she subsequently stopped the third drug. Well, she goes back to her gastroenterologist who had advised a colon removal, colectomy. And she says, look at me. I'm the healthiest I've been in years. I'm skinnier, and I don't have ulcerative colitis anymore. He says, well, what did you do? And she told him, you know, no wheat, no grains, et cetera. And he said, it's a coincidence. Go back to what you were doing. Yeah, didn't ask, did I miss something here? Tell me more in detail what you did, right? And I've seen this over and over again, the lack of curiosity, even confronted what seems to be, you know, at least say, well, I don't understand. What did you do? None of that. And so it's so important for all of us to have a curiosity. And you know this, Abel, because I think you're the same way. You're a lifelong learner, and it's driven by curiosity.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah. And we never, when it comes to health, have it completely figured out. And as soon as you do, something changes on you, right?
Yeah, you know, I cringe. I thought I knew a lot about health 10 years ago. And I'm realizing how little we all knew. You know, pulling back the curtain on this microbiome. Wow, there's so much to know, so much we still don't know. But the tools we're gaining with insights into the microbiome are astounding. And it's causing a complete redefinition, reclassification, rethinking about almost all health conditions, putting aside injury and infection, of course. We're talking about the things that we're all familiar with, like diabetes, obesity, autoimmune diseases, headaches, depression, Alzheimer's disease, cancer. We're having to rethink all these conditions now in light of what we're learning about the microbiome.
Because it turns out we're not just eating calories. We're eating a whole bunch of different variables which affect our bodies in unique ways. Even the same body on a different day can treat these calories and foods as a completely different and novel substance in a lot of cases. And you've said this before, we're feeding our gut, we're feeding our microbiome, and we don't know quite so much about that yet. We know a little bit. Do we know enough? I don't know, maybe enough to make some seriously good changes, but certainly not everything.
You know, one fundamental unanswered question is, what's a healthy microbiome, a gastrointestinal microbiome specifically? What's it look like? What's it supposed to look like? So no one really knows. What does we say eubiosis as opposed to dysbiosis, disrupted microbiome? What does eubiosis look like? Should you and I have the microbiome composition, say, of a hunter-gatherer? Who they've had their microbiomes sequenced, like the Yanomami in the Brazilian rainforest, some of the people who live deep in the jungles of New Guinea, people along the east coast of Africa, the Malawi, the Maasai, the Hadza. All these people have had their gastrointestinal microbiomes studied, and interestingly, they're completely different than from ours. But even though these populations are separated by oceans and thousands of miles, they all have microbiome compositions that look oddly alike. Suggesting, of course, that they have the ancestral form or the so-called Stone Age form of microbiome. Should we look like them? Probably not, but maybe there's some lessons to take from what looks like the original microbiome.
Well, and in their case as well, they haven't applied napalm from the inside out and just pretty much torched every thing that was alive on the inside from the inside out over and over with antibiotics over the course of their life, or even environmental factors. So to some degree, we need to counteract that with some of the methods and strategies that you've outlined in your work, whether that's food or specific strains of probiotics and that sort of thing. So anyway, we do seem to understand that our gut, generally speaking, is out of whack with where we came from. And there are certain things that we can do to hopefully push it back in the right direction. But some of those things are surprising, aren't they?
Mm-hmm. You know, I tell people, because they get a little freaked out about all this stuff, so I tell them, think of it as like having a backyard springtime garden. If you want to have a garden, how do you do that? Well, you go out in your backyard and you clear an area, maybe a 10 by 10 plot. You pick out the weeds and the stones and the sticks, and then you plant some seeds, and then you water and fertilize your garden over the growing season. At the end of a couple of 3 months, you have your tomatoes and cucumbers and zucchini, etc. Cultivating a healthy gastrointestinal microbiome. By the way, we should also talk about the other microbiomes too, the airway, brain, uterus, vagina, bladder, the urinary bladder has a microbiome. But back to the garden. So the same principle applies to your gastrointestinal garden. And that is, we're going to clear the soil, that is, remove factors in modern life that are disrupting it, like chlorinated drinking water, glyphosate residues and other herbicides, or choose organic. Avoid drugs best you can that disrupt the microbiome, like stomach acid blocking drugs, anti-inflammatory drugs, statin cholesterol drugs. Minimize your exposure to antibiotics, of course. Food additives like preservatives that kill microbes in food and in you. Emulsifying agents like polysorbate 80 in common foods like ice cream that emulsify the mucus barrier lining your and protecting your gastrointestinal tract. So that's the whole long list of things. It sounds complicated. It's not. Once you incorporate these practices into your everyday life, it's very easy. But that's preparing the soil. The seeds, the most important seeds you can plant are fermented foods. These are foods that most people are somewhat familiar with, like kombucha, kimchi, sauerkraut, vegetables you ferment on your kitchen counter. It's so easy. Probiotics have a role, but people often view probiotics as the sole solution. They are not. The current crop of commercial probiotics are too haphazardly created. I think the probiotic of the future will be much more effective, incorporating such things as collaborative guilds or consortia. That is, microbes collaborate with each other. They're like humans. We don't live in isolation. We have a partner, families, coworkers, neighbors, communities. Microbes are the same. And when you take a haphazardly concocted commercial probiotic, there's no collaborative effect built into that collection of microbes that's starting to come. And there's some other improvements that need to be made, including greater counts of microbes. There's emerging data that you really need hundreds of billions in many cases to have meaningful biologic effects. And so a lot of commercial probiotics have 100 to 1,000 fold less than that. So lots of improvement there, but they still do play something of a role. And then lastly, the water and fertilizer of your microbiome are the fibers that microbes need, as well as some other components of mostly plant matter. So I worry about the people who've gone completely carnivorous or ketogenic or low FODMAPs diet, low fiber, sugar diet, where if you starve your microbes because you're not feeding them the plant matter, the fibers and other factors like polyphenols, weird stuff happens. And some of those changes may be irreversible. One example is, so modern humans have decimated the diversity of our gastrointestinal microbiome. We've lost hundreds of species, literally lost them. And when you starve your microbes, because you went on a ketogenic diet, carnivorous diet, low FODMAPs, you even have a further reduction in diversity. And diversity, high diversity is a marker of health, low diversity a marker for poor health. So there's a drop in diversity. There's some odd phenomena, like there's a bacterial species called Acromantia. And Acromantia does fine when you feed it fibers like asparagus or onions or shallots or leeks or dandelion greens. Acromantia is happy and it helps you control your blood sugar and blood pressure and sleep and the dream content, mood. It supports other microbes. It supports your mucus lining. But when you starve it of those fibers, it has this, other microbes are disappearing. Acromantia thrives. Its full name is Acromantia mucinophila, mucus lover. It starts to eat your intestinal mucus, and it expands in numbers. So it occupies 20%, 24% of all microbes, and it's eating its way through you, and you get colitis and intestinal inflammation. You get a process called endotoxemia, where bacterial breakdown products enter the bloodstream. And that's the process, by the way, endotoxemia. That explains how microbes can be in the gastrointestinal tract can be experienced in the brain as depression or as Alzheimer's dementia or Parkinson's disease or in muscles and joints as fibromyalgia or rheumatoid arthritis or as in skin as rosacea, psoriasis, or eczema or metabolically as fatty liver, type 2 diabetes, and obesity. And so so in that garden, prepare the soil, plant your seeds, water and fertilize them, and you'll have a happy microbiome.
But geez, it's making me think of all the people who have gone hardcore keto or carnivore in the past few years, and they're just like, I lost 2 or 3 pounds right away and had all this change to elimination that's kind of an issue too. And I'm just linking that. It's like, oh, maybe you lost 3 pounds of your entire microbiome right away, which wouldn't be a good thing. Not that you lose those right away necessarily, but a lot of these interventions where you're kicking the veggies out, people are doing it 30 plus days. And so we don't know exactly what's going on. Some people do lose weight, but that's not necessarily a good thing if we're working on growing that garden from the inside out, as you say.
Yeah, you know, I've had a lot of people kind of leave those programs and come over to us, and they struggle because they have massively disrupted their microbiomes. And so, I think back, my litmus tests for a lot of these things is just to ask, what did primitive humans do? That is a style of eating and behavior that's programmed into our genetic code. So I often point out that you saw a lion and it killed a gazelle, tore open its stomach and chest and ate the heart and the intestines and the stomach, et cetera. And you say, that's disgusting. We're not going to allow that anymore. We're going to put that lion in a cage and feed it ale and spinach. What's going to happen to the lion? It's going to die, right? Because you violated the style of eating that's programmed into its genetic code acquired over millions and millions of years. Humans are no different. We may have a wider range of food that's appropriate for us than a lion, but there's still needs and things we don't need all programmed into our genetic code. And one of the things that humans are good at is adaptation to changing conditions when meats are available, meat and organs are available, and when they're not available. So we can adapt. But if you go one very strict style and starve your microbes, and that's when the weird stuff starts to happen. And I fear sometimes these are not reversible.
Yeah. And geez, it's a lot harder to start from scratch with that gut microbiome when you have less to grasp onto in terms of those. I don't want to take the metaphor too far, but just, you know, those deeply entrenched species that have been there for a long time that you said we're losing out on because also our family members have lost out and our community members and all the rest of it. It's just not really in our environment, not in the foods, not in our stomachs, and not in our microbiome anymore. So trying to build that back up can be quite the process. But in the modern world, who doesn't have to do that? Even the people who fiercely avoid antibiotics, like some of the people who we've been coaching for more than a decade, they're just like, listen, I avoided antibiotics as much as I could for 10 years, but then I just got this thing and I had to go on a hardcore round. My gut is all messed up. I gained a bunch of weight. What should people like them do to kind of start over in that case?
Well, one of the things you can try to do, I mean, always question the need for that antibiotic. In other words, if you had a viral upper respiratory infection, chances are you don't need an antibiotic. So always question the need. If you must, let's say you have a bad urinary tract infection, especially when that ascended into the kidneys, pyelonephritis, make sure you get some Saccharomyces boulardii. What we do is we take that commercial probiotic, it's widely available, it's called Florastore in the U.S., take one capsule, empty it into any volume of juice, Just be sure the juice doesn't have any kind of preservatives like potassium sorbate or sodium benzoate. So empty the Florister capsule into juice, cap it, agitate lightly, and then loosen the cap and leave it on your kitchen counter. At 24 hours, you're going to see it bubbling like mad, producing so much carbon dioxide. But got to keep that cap loose, because if you don't, it's going to explode. And then by 48 hours, you want to refrigerate it to stop the fermentation or slow the fermentation process. It still has some sugar in it. The sugar has been reduced by half by the process of fermentation by the Saccharomyces. But if you can consume about a quarter cup or so several times a day during an antibiotic, it's the best thing you can do that protects your gastrointestinal microbiome. It's not quite clear how this works, but it's the best thing that's been ever studied that preserves your microbiome, or at least minimizes the damage. That's one thing you can do. Fermented foods, beyond Saccharomyces boulardii, fermented foods. And these can be so simple, just cucumbers, radishes, garlic, veggies that you ferment on your kitchen counter should cost no more than the cost of your vegetables. Even better, grow them yourself. And you can start with a starter culture that you buy, or you can, as you get better and better cultivating microbes, you can use some of the microbes you've already cultivated, or you can allow the microbes resident on the surface of the vegetable to do it for you. It'll take a little longer, but you can do that too. What's curious about that, Abel, is the fermenting microbes in fermented veggies. These are a species like Leuconostoc mesenteroides or Pediococcus pentosaceus or Lactobacillus plantarum. These are typically not the microbes that take up residence in your GI tract. There's something peculiar that happens. You have those fermenting microbes pass through, and they have, by the way, spectacular health benefits, but they don't take up residence. They just pass through. But somehow their passage opens the door to restoring many lost microbes. No one knows how that happens. Are they just present in low numbers but kind of quiescent? Or does it make you somehow receptive to microbes from other people, other sources like your dog or surfaces in your kitchen or out in public? So no, not quite clear how. But if we believe the data from Stanford, from the Sonnenbergs, Erica and Justin, the husband-wife team, they published a very important study showing that one of the most important things you can do is consume lots and lots of fermented foods.
But we're seeing people kick those out more than ever, it seems like. That, I mean, as alluring as it has always been to not eat your vegetables because it's more fun to eat other things, I've never seen that become so popular as now. Have you? It's befuddling, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, when you see people going to the fast food restaurants and eating what is essentially garbage, yeah, it is sad. You, me, your listeners have a lot of work to do. You know, we're also having to uneducate, make people forget the dietary blunders of 40, 50 years.
Yeah.
You cut your fat, cut your cholesterol, cut your saturated fat, eat more healthy whole grains, everything in moderation, all that stuff. You know, I'm kind of grateful, Abel, that we went through that process because it showed us how awful it is when you do the wrong thing. You know, these epidemics, of course, of obesity and type 2 diabetes, as well as dementia and autoimmune diseases and neurodegeneration, these are all on the rise. It's not an accident. We caused it. Humans caused it. Not entirely just due to dietary guidelines. That's a big part of it, the blunders of dietary guidelines, but also the predatory practices of big food and a lot of things going on around us. Microplastics, maybe EMF. I mean, a lot of crazy things going on around us.
Well, and also, we've talked about this before, but the questions still always go in this direction. What about cholesterol? What about the garbage science around cholesterol that has still been repeated 50 plus years later? Maybe you can just riff and rant on that a little bit, and we can talk about some ways to measure what the cholesterol people are after anyway through a more appropriate metric.
Yeah, the real tragedy of focusing on cholesterol and such things as saturated fat is it took everybody's attentions away from the real causes of heart disease. That's why over 80 million Americans take statin cholesterol drugs. It's had virtually zero impact on the incidence of cardiovascular disease. And that's why hospitals still add on new $80 million, $100 million wings for cardiovascular disease, because heart disease remains the biggest moneymaker for the healthcare system. And so cholesterol It came from work at the National Institutes of Health and elsewhere in the 1950s, 1960s, when they were trying to characterize the particles in the bloodstream, lipoproteins, fat-carrying proteins, that appeared to be the cause of heart disease, coronary disease, heart attack, that sort of thing. Well, in 1958, it was not easy to measure these things in the bloodstream. So what doctors William Friedewald and Fredrickson did was they took the plasma part of your blood, that's the blood minus red blood cells, spun it down at high speed in a centrifuge, and you see the plasma layer out. High density falls to the bottom, low density goes to the top, and several layers in between. Well, how do you quantify and characterize the particles in that liquid? Not easy. So they said, we know what they're made of. We know there's various fats like triglycerides, cholesterol. There's proteins like apoprotein B and C and E. Let's pick one thing. We're going to pick cholesterol, and we're going to measure cholesterol in each fraction. And that was meant to indirectly and crudely estimate or guesstimate how many particles were in each layer. And the low density fraction, there's a high density at the bottom, very low density at the top, low density in the middle. That's the hardest to measure. So they used a crude calculation to guesstimate how much cholesterol was in the low density fraction. That was the origin of cholesterol testing, LDL cholesterol. And so they knew this. It was very crude. You have to make assumptions when you use that little calculation they made. You assume everybody eats the same diet. You assume everybody has good triglyceride levels. Nobody is diabetic or pre-diabetic. A bunch of assumptions, which of course are not true.
Yeah, it's a lot of assumptions.
Right. And so we can't blame the NIH scientists. They were working 70 years ago.
Sure, yeah.
Imagine our phone technology was the same technology as 1958. And we don't have these glorious smartphones. Well, that's what's happened here. The technology we're using for detection of risk for heart disease is woefully out of date. Should have been rejected, discarded decades ago. Because it's not as if there aren't superior methods. When you look at those superior methods that reveal the causes for heart disease, you start to realize, you know, heart disease is a disease of diet and some other factors, insulin resistance, inflammation, and they're all correctable without drugs. Now, wait a minute here, but that's the pot of gold. So maintaining the status quo pays really well.
Yeah.
Pharmaceutical industry makes billions and billions of dollars every year, and they had done so for going on 30 years now from the statin and other drugs. And my colleagues continue to open these new heart centers and charge all kinds of money to do heart procedures. So if we turn that all off, right, a lot of people are going to get hurt. So that's why the status quo is maintained while people like your listeners and other people continue to have heart attacks, angina, sudden cardiac death, et cetera. Gaining control over cardiovascular risk is really easy. And it has nothing to do with cholesterol, has little to do with statin cholesterol drugs, has nothing to do with saturated fat, none of that stuff. We've wasted 50 years, Abel, on this house of cards, all the while better methods were already available.
Like coronary calcium score, for example, right? Which you can measure and hopefully you can reverse to some degree with these lifestyle interventions, right?
Have done it many, many, many times. Yep. So in case your listener's not familiar with that, so you can measure calcium in coronary artery. And of course, my colleagues say, but we don't care about hard plaque. No, it's not a measure of hard plaque. It's a measure of total plaque. Because my friend, Dr. John Rumberger, when he was at Mayo Clinic, he showed that if you have 10 cubic millimeters of atherosclerotic plaque lining your arteries, 2 cubic millimeters are consistently calcium. So calcium is like a dipstick or a gauge for how much atherosclerotic plaque you have in your arteries. And the more plaque you have, the more you're at risk for such things as rupture, that's a heart attack, sudden cardiac death, et cetera. So we can measure it. That's the actual disease itself. It's not an indirect like a cholesterol. Now, you can identify the causes very easily. We don't use cholesterol testing. I haven't done cholesterol testing in a long, long time. So we do lipoprotein testing. And you'll see there's two patterns that emerge. There's VLDL, very low density lipoprotein, and small LDL particles. That sounds complicated, but it's not. So very low density lipoproteins, VLDL, come from consumption of carbohydrates, the amylopectin of wheat and grains, and and sugars like sucrose and fructose. And your liver is very good at converting those carbs and sugars to triglycerides, carbs to fat. Triglycerides are fats. And that's called lipogenesis or de novo lipogenesis, making fats. So liver is very good at it. So you feed your liver all these carbs and it makes triglycerides that enter the bloodstream as VLDL, because triglycerides are fat. You can't have free floating fat in the bloodstream. So it gets coupled with a protein, lipoprotein, VLDL, very low density lipoprotein. And VLDL is a very potent cause for heart disease. And VLDL interacts with LDL particles, not LDL cholesterol, LDL particles themselves, and makes them small. Small LDL particles are the cause for coronary disease, atherosclerotic plaque. They're small. They're better able to infiltrate arteries, the walls. It's more adherent. They're more prone to oxidation and glycation, glucose modification. So they come from sugars. And when they interact with sugars, makes them much more dangerous. And small LDL gets access into your arteries, much more adherent, much more likely to trigger an inflammatory response. And they last 5 to 7 days because your liver doesn't recognize them, doesn't clear them. As compared to large LDL particles that come after eating fat, they last for about 24 hours. So that one bagel or one sandwich on whole wheat bread gives you cardiovascular risk for about a week. And so I learned this years ago because I tell people, hey, we're going to take out wheat and grains because you have 2,400 nanomoles per liter particle count per volume, small LDL particles. They come back 6 months later, so, and it's down to 900. I say, now it's better. It's a lot better, but it's not gone. We want close to zero. Oh, are you doing your diet? Yeah. Oh, yes, I am. I am. Are you sure? Well, Friday is my bad day. I allow myself one slice of pizza or something like that, you know? And but that's how bad that bagel, sandwich, small bowl of pasta is. When it comes to cardiovascular risk, it is a flagrant. So, you know, Abel, so if you tell people, cut your fat, eat more healthy whole grains, you might as well say, go smoke two packs of Marlboros. You just gave them the formula for causing heart disease.
Isn't that amazing? Now, how do we reconcile that, though, with, for example, if you do have a large expenditure of energy that depletes your glycogen stores. What's the best way to, for runners out there or athletes or people who are really burning through a lot of those carbs because it's higher intensity activity, what is the best way to refuel that while avoiding some of those bad effects? Or is there a way? Are you just taking the hit? Like if you're someone who is a long-term runner and has been for a long time, for example, and you're constantly fueling with these carbs and kind of on that train, are you just taking the long-term damage or are there ways to mitigate that as you refuel glycogen?
So you can appreciate, Abel, if you're drinking those drinks or eating those bars, you're giving yourself heart disease, as well as all the other consequences of high blood glucose, like adding to risk for cognitive impairment. So, I mean, a lot of problems. You're changing your microbiome, your gastrointestinal microbiome. And so I think the key here is to, over time, get off those things and allow your body to ramp up. It may take some weeks, though, to ramp up its ability to mobilize fat stores rather than glycogen stores. And that seems to work for the majority. That is, it won't happen overnight. You can't go from carb loading to no carb at all and expect to be able to go the distance
right.
You have
it takes
before.
Time. Yeah.
Yeah, it takes time. But all that carb loading business is very dangerous.
Yes, and we've seen from years ago up to now a lot of extremely competitive athletes, some of them still with their body composition intact and very athletic. But you look inside their bodies and you look at the state of their heart, their arteries and all the rest of it. And they are a mess. They're a ticking time bomb. And so that's one of the confounding factors, right? For people looking from the outside in, it's like all these professional athletes aren't at the peak of health. How does that work? So maybe we can dig into that a little bit more, because there, we don't want to go too far to the keto edge of things, right? You do need some amount of fiber and plant foods and all the rest of it. But I think what I hear you saying is you want to avoid the highly processed, high glycemic flours, drinks, syrups, and that sort of thing, and refuel your glycogen and fuel your body with more real food.
Like nut butters or something like that. Another added complexity to this, Abel, is the genetic pattern called lipoprotein A. So lipoprotein A, it's inherited, and the typical lipoprotein A person is slender, very fit, capable of long-distance aerobic exercise, and they gravitate toward it. They love long-distance running, biking, swimming. So you see a lot of them at marathons or triathlons. They tend to be very good at math, oddly. They are unusually tolerant to water and food deprivation. And they can develop heart disease in your 30s, 40s, premature heart disease. So here's a person, slender, fit, right? Smart, who gets heart disease. So, of course, the conventional question is, what drug do people with lipoprotein A need? I think we should ask different questions. I think we should ask this. Now, wait a minute here. They're smart, aerobically very capable, can go long distances and long periods of time without food or water, right? I think lipoprotein is a survival advantage. It's a cardiovascular risk factor, yes, but it's a survival advantage if we lived in a wild setting. Because it means that, you know, if I said to one of your listeners, hey, here's a spear, go kill something. How long is it going to take you to spear a deer or a moose? It's going to take you a long time. You may have to run it down for 6 hours. You can't stop to eat or drink. You want to be smart. You can outsmart your prey, set a trap maybe. You want to be smarter than other predators, other animals. And so I think lipoprotein A is a survival advantage. So here's, it's a different question. Well, that's true. What brings out this alternative face of aggressive premature heart disease? Well, as you point out, you look at these slender, fit, long-distance runners, say, and they're metabolic mess. They have high high blood sugars, often in the pre-diabetic or even diabetic range, even though they're fit and slender. They have oodles of small LDL particles, lots of VLDL particles and triglycerides, high hemoglobin A1C. They're metabolic messes. Now, everybody gets some degree of a metabolic mess when you do things like eat too many carbs and cut your fat. But these are slender, long distance people, and yet they still look they look like they're obese type 2 diabetic when you look at them. And I think it's because lipoprotein A, you are prone to these patterns, small LDL, VLDL, high blood sugar, et cetera, but more so than other people are, even though you're slender and very fit. And so, because you hear this, right? Oh, does marathon running cause heart disease? Well, it does. It can. If you're lipoprotein A, you do something crazy like carb load.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's a bit startling because I've been a lifelong runner, not elite or pro or anything like that, but more for fun. And I really enjoy going out there. But a lot of people who are involved in athletics, they are going after ultimate performance. They want the fastest time. They want to lift the most weight, whatever it is. So if you look at the bell curve, the people who are running and training for marathons, I know when I was, I could come back home and eat a whole pie because I had just burned through so many calories and I'm famished and my body wants. So people who have a pattern of doing that, thankfully, I only did that for a relatively short amount of a few months with that amount of activity. But these people who have been doing, the triathletes and the people who have been running marathons and all the rest of that, just to continuously fuel that, you could be accelerating disease in a pretty major way, such that if you're training that way, you're actually reducing your lifespan and your health span. When if you're training
not necessarily for the fastest time or the longest distance, but more if you're training for your lifestyle and to feel good and to be healthy, then maybe you should dial back the training, dial back the eating, and certainly dial back the carb loading.
Absolutely. And look all the heat Tim Noakes took. Tim Noakes took.
Oh, yeah.
He changed course.
Yep. That was so important, though, and it's important that other people realize that, too, because we have this tendency to be, I remember growing up, and it's like, me and pretty much everyone around me in elementary school wanted to be Michael Jordan. We wanted to be some sort of professional athlete. I remember, I think it was Dr. Kate Shanahan I had on, talking about Dwight Howard and a few of the other athletes, pro athletes, who have these problems with sugar that you would not believe, that are just churning through enormous amounts. And then you see, if you follow a lot of pro athletes later in their careers, after they retire, it's like they're not maintaining their performance or body composition. Maybe they reached that ultimate pinnacle of performance for a little while, but perhaps that was at the expense of their health. And that's a hard thing to swallow. But for those of us training for a long, happy, healthy life, it's really important to know that and accept that and maybe adjust our training appropriately. And there is some sort of happy middle there. Even when it comes to, I think it was Noakes as well, some of his work, he's saying, well, don't run the 4-minute mile, like 7 minutes and 30 seconds or 8 minutes, 9 minutes. That's great. That's even better for you. And people don't want to hear that, especially runners.
Well said, Abel. You know what's changing? I think things, surprisingly, the availability of continuous glucose monitors.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Because it's showing that the absurdity, for instance, in thinking that oatmeal is good for you. No, it's not. It's awful for you. That's why you see those sky high blood sugars. A non-diabetic can show diabetic blood sugars just after eating a bowl of organic oatmeal with no added sugar. And of course, you know, if you have a blood sugar of 170 after eating a bowl of oatmeal, that a lot of those effects are irreversible. And in other words, it takes you faster down the path of eroding joints, cognitive impairment, heart disease, other problems. So, you know, my daughter's a pro tennis player, and she'd go on and off cutting her carbs and eating better. But, you know, everybody around her, including when you go to these professional events, they've got all the drinks and bars everywhere because they're sponsors and they're encouraged. The athletes are encouraged to consume those things. And so sometimes they just give in just because of pressure. Well, she got the consumer a version of the continuous glucose meter. And she called me up in a panic because she's having super duper high blood sugars and she's slender and active. She trains hours a day and yet she's showing. So it made her smart really fast.
Jeez. Yeah. I've experimented with a number of rounds of continuous glucose monitoring, and it's been very, very powerful. But one thing I have noticed is that a relatively moderate amount of carbs didn't seem to be that big of a deal. But that threshold, as soon as I cross it from whatever it is, a palm-sized portion of a little bit of oatmeal or one little bit of bread or something like that, compared to the normal serving sizes that most people are eating at restaurants or at cafeterias or just in their day-to-day life, which tends to be many, many multiples of what a reasonable portion size would be for a starch. There's a massive, massive difference. But I did find that I could get away with a little bit, especially after training, or maybe my glycogen stores needed to be refueled a little bit and could tolerate it. I did get a spike, but it wasn't major. But to get that major spike, it really doesn't take much, even if you are a pro tennis player or someone who is trying to out exercise a bad diet in some cases without even realizing it, right?
Absolutely.
And it's extremely difficult, perhaps even impossible, to out-exercise that diet. But even those athletes out there, pretty much everyone, once you have your data, it's staring you in the face, and it's scary. It's really scary to think that you're trying to be healthy and it's making you die faster or accelerating aging or clogging your arteries and doing all the things you're trying to avoid.
And you're able, it took 50 years of blundering with dietary guidelines and predatory food practices that shows us this is what happens. You're going to have epidemics of type 2 diabetes, obesity, autoimmune diseases, etc., cognitive impairment, Alzheimer's. When you do things like cut your fat, cut your cholesterol, increase your grains, and don't mind the things that raise blood sugar. So it took us 50 years, Abel, to get here, but it's going to unwind, I think, over the next decade or so.
But then the answer itself isn't necessarily on the other side either. I've heard you talk about when they've experimented with ketogenic diets for kids, especially as a therapeutic approach to treating seizures and that sort of things. But the other effects on their lifestyle aren't necessarily positive. Maybe you could talk about that a little.
Yeah, ironically, as you know, ketogenic diets have been around for about a century. They've changed over the years. They've gotten better, but there's still a lot of problems. So this question has been asked numerous times. If you have a child, a 3-year-old, a 12-year-old, whatever, who's having intractable grand mal seizures and thereby at risk for brain damage and unresponsive or fully to drugs and even procedures, there's about a 50% reduction in seizure frequency with a ketogenic diet. And so this question has been asked, what happens to those kids? Well, they've been tracked, including the more modern groups of kids. Because in the old days, they used to do crazy stuff, like give these kids a bunch of corn oil. No one's doing that now.
Thankfully,
now they're doing more like coconut oil or olive oil, healthier oils. And so these kids on ketogenic diets stop growing. They develop kidney stones. These are kids. They shouldn't get kidney stones, but about 8% of them develop kidney stones. Some of them develop osteopenia or osteoporosis. These are kids, you know, a 13-year-old with osteopenia, like a 84-year-old woman. They change their gastrointestinal microbiome. Like we talked about before, you have a drop in species diversity and you have appearance of mucus consuming species, such as acromantia. There's a few others also. And so we know. Now, those kids don't have much of a choice because they're going to have seizures. But those of us not having seizures, when you go on a ketogenic diet or other form of a super duper low carb diet without minding your intake of those that plant matter and prebiotic fibers, then weird stuff happens.
So we have to find some middle road. Where does that leave us, especially after all of the books that you've written, all of the people you've worked with and treated, the conversations you've had? What are some things that in today's world we can carry forward? Because it's not this extreme or that extreme where you're carb loading or going extremely ketogenic. It's really somewhere in the middle, talking about eating fermented foods, focusing on fiber from plant foods, getting a diversity of foods, making sure that your meats aren't the worst quality ever with all sorts of disgusting chemicals in them that could disrupt your microbiome and all the rest of it. Maybe you could give just a general approach for people out there. What is that middle road of health?
Well, if you have meat, buy a fatty cut. Don't trim off the fat, eat the fat. Try to get more liver. You know, I'd like to see this happen, but I don't think it's going to happen. A return to consumption of heart, tongue, kidney, thyroid, thymus, brain. That's how we got, by the way, collagen and hyaluronic acid. You know, collagen is essential. The FDA won't say this, but the collagen is a nutrient that we need. And when you get collagen, ladies love it because they start to lose skin wrinkles. It actually rebuilds cartilage in your knees and hips. It probably has a brain benefit. It reduces blood pressure. And yet most modern people are getting next to no collagen. And we're told stupid things, right? Like eat skinless, boneless chicken breast.
Right.
They threw all the good stuff away. The skin is loaded with hyaluronic acid. Because that's important for brain health, skin health, because it goes to the dermis and holds water. So ladies start, once again, lose their wrinkles. It goes to the joints, the synovial fluid, the lubricating fluid of joints, and provides lubrication. And hyaluronic acid also promotes growth of more collagen. And hyaluronic acid is probably one of the most important things a woman can do for the inevitable vaginal atrophy and dryness that ladies get into their late 60s and 70s, which it can ruin relationships and it's painful and repeated infections. And so, but because those are necessary nutrients that modern people aren't getting because no one wants to, they're throwing away the skin. They're not saving the bones and cartilage and tendons and ligaments, making a broth or soup out of it. And so don't mind the fat, eat the fat. If you can, get some organs. If there's a vegetable matter to pay attention to, it's the stuff that carries those prebiotic fibers. It's asparagus and leeks and dandelion greens and legumes like white beans, black beans. You want to be mindful of carb intake because, as you know, if you're wearing a CGM, a continuous glucose meter monitor, you don't want to get high, sky-high blood sugars, nor do you want to provoke small LDL particles and lipogenesis in your liver. So we do have to mind carbs. Most of us acquire so much insulin resistance that's one thing we pay attention to. No one's counting calories. There's no benefit to in fact, counting calories, this conversation, Abel, hasn't really gained traction, but counting calories, limiting calories, it's a very damaging process. I've been thinking a lot about this because, you know, all the conventional methods of weight loss, you know, we live in a world of overweight and obese people, unfortunately, and they're told to cut their calories or move more, eat less, or take a pharmaceutical like Contrave or Ozempic or Wegovy, or submit to a bariatric procedure like gastric bypass or lap band or a balloon. Well, those are all forms of calorie restriction. And we know that when you cut calories, bad things happen. One, your metabolic rate goes way down. So that's why those biggest loser people, they lost 50 pounds, 70 pounds, 130 pounds during the show by following a low-calorie diet and extreme exercise. And they're miserable, of course. That's why they're always sobbing. And then when they left the show, they all regained all the weight. And their metabolic rate was 23% lower than it was supposed to, even, and it persisted for years. So cutting calories, whether we call it calorie reduction or biggest loser or Contrave or Wegovy or bariatric surgery, guarantees that you regain the weight because you turn down your metabolic rate. Another thing that happens is loss of muscle. You know, on those GLP-1 agonist drugs like Ozempic and Wegovy, up to 40% of the weight you lose is lost muscle. So if you lose 50 pounds, you lost 20 pounds of muscle. Imagine losing 20 pounds of muscle. That's why, I don't know if you heard this conversation in media called Ozempic face. People lose 30, 40, 50 pounds, but they look like they're 10 or 20 years older because they lost muscle. And those calorie reduction, the worst fat of all is abdominal visceral fat. The problem is not obesity. It's abdominal visceral fat. Fat on your thighs, calves, chest, arms, neck. You might not like it. Maybe it hurts your self-esteem and it does put some stress on weight-bearing joints, but that's not the fat that's responsible for heart disease risk, dementia risk, cancer risk, diabetes. That's all abdominal fat that drains to the liver. And so all those calorie counting methods, drugs, bariatric surgery, et cetera, preferentially target subcutaneous fat, not abdominal visceral fat. When you cut carbs, like eliminate wheat, grains, and sugars, and we also add some nutrients that are lacking in modern life that address insulin resistance, when you address insulin resistance, the abdomen shrinks preferentially, and you don't lose muscle. So all those people being told cut their calories, move more, eat less, all that stuff are being given a very damaging message, and one that doesn't work.
Yeah, and it snowballs into even more negative effects down the road because you're – especially as the years tick by, your muscle is really your best tool to maintain your quality of life and especially the quality of your metabolism, right?
Exactly right. Yeah. People who lose a lot of muscle are much more prone to frailty, dementia, falls, osteoporosis, fractures. And there's even evidence to suggest when you lose muscle, your mortality rate goes up. So telling people to move more, eat less, or putting them on a pharmaceutical to lose weight or doing a bariatric procedure is a really bad way to deal with weight.
Yeah.
But it makes money.
Yeah. Good gracious. Oh, one point before I forget about eating those cuts of meat that are fattier or with the skin. I noticed that, you know, if you go out and you get chicken breast, for example, it's going to be quite expensive. Who even knows what it is in today's economy? But the drumsticks and the wings and the ones that actually do have collagen and skin and cartilage and the gnarly stuff in there and the tendons that you have to chew on, that's a fraction. It might be half or one third of the cost of the skinless, boneless pieces. And so in many cases, especially if you're looking to make a broth, you can get better quality meat and pretty much a free broth if you keep the bones and throw those in after the fact. So you're eating for a fraction of the cost. You're getting much better nutrition by choosing those actually lower cost pieces of meat that no one else really wants because they're all after the chicken breast, right?
Exactly right.
It's like
you're getting collagen, hyaluronic acid, saturated fat, which is good for you, stuff out of the bone marrow, all the good stuff. Yeah. Exactly. The worst you could do is boneless, skinless chicken breast. I look at that and I...
No, thank you. No, thank you. Well, we've just got a little bit of time left, but I want to make sure that we quickly cover what's coming in the world of health with artificial intelligence and all these newfangled tools and platforms and technology out there. What are you optimistic about? Where do you think we're going in the world of health?
Well, I don't know how AI is going to impact it. You know, it will be subverted into the cause of pharmaceuticals and procedures. That's how healthcare works. You know, healthcare, the first question for healthcare is not how do you become healthy? It's how do we profit more?
Right, right.
From condition X, whatever. So they're going to use it for that purpose. And maybe it does advance pharmaceuticals. But you can see the whole pharmaceutical model is very limited. If you have, let's say, rheumatoid arthritis, and there's a sequence of events that leads to that disease and the erosion of your joints, the pharmaceutical approach is, hey, there's one mediator of this effect. Let's block it. Rather than say, now, what was the initiating factor or factors? Was it lack of vitamin D? Was it proliferation of fecal microbes in the small bowel that exported their toxic products into your bloodstream, endotoxemia, and other factors? So in conventional healthcare, almost never do they ask, what's the initiating cause? They just say, let's block that pathway. That's why you have side effects. And of course, they're also pricing drugs absurdly. I don't know if you heard this. There's the first drug that costs about $3 million for a year. A year's supply.
$3 million.
Yeah. There's astonishing. A lot of drugs now that are in the $60,000 a year range. A lot of them.
Gosh.
And you know, even if you don't, if you and I don't take them or your listeners don't take them, it raises healthcare costs because there's going to be that person who does take it and the tide goes up for all of us. So I don't know what's going to happen in conventional healthcare, but I can say, I think the tools that you and I and your listeners have access to now, further strengthened by our insights in the microbiome. So some of the things we're achieving with microbes, it's absolutely astounding. Look what we're doing with lactobacillus reuteri.
Yes.
I know you and your family consume.
Yeah.
That has all kinds of wonderful effects. And we're trying to corroborate this more and more and more in humans. Takes time, though. Takes time and money. But the original studies suggested increased thickness of the skin with increased dermal collagen, acceleration of healing, reduction of appetite, turns off your desire for snacking, increases libido. And, you know, all the people who've been making the lactobacillus reuteri yogurt, that is, it's not yogurt, of course, it looks like yogurt, but we use it to amplify bacterial counts about 1,000-fold using extended fermentation. It's very easy. It's fun. And we're seeing all the effects in humans who consume the yogurt, like smoother skin, reduction of wrinkles, increased muscle mass, reduction of appetite, increased libido, vaginal moisture, deeper sleep with vivid dreams, or seeing all these things play out. That's just one microbe, of course, Abel. There's many other microbes you can play with that have some pretty spectacular effects. One of the, in our first human clinical trial with reuteri and other components, we did see some really cool skin effects. It was mostly done for skin. We used something called high-resolution skin ultrasound, and we did document about a 14.5% increase in the thickness of the dermis. And the ladies who participated were very happy because they got increased moisture, luster, all the things that ladies pay attention to. But we had, completely by surprise, an unexpected and dramatic influence on body composition. Complete change. So we're going to explore that. We're in the midst of raising the money now to fund, because that's a very expensive study. So we'll do that, I hope, within the next year or so. So that I hope next time I talk to you, I can say, Abel, here's how you have a dramatic effect on your body's shape and composition. And even without exercise, even without strength training, even without diet, we want people to exercise and diet, right? But even if you don't do that, I think we've got a way to have a dramatic effect on body composition. So I can't talk about too much about it right now, but hopefully maybe in a year or so I can say, aha, here's how you do it. Here's what we did. We documented it in a clinical trial.
That's wonderful. So it sounds like if you don't want to spend $60,000 to $3 million a year on all of these pharmaceuticals, then you should clear some counter space, start your broth with those bones that are left over from your chicken dinner. And then you get some, hopefully some veggies fermenting as well. And then you clear some space and make some of that reuteri yogurt as well. And all of a sudden, you're going to be happy and healthy for many years to come and saving a bucket of money as well.
And, you know, Abel, if you follow that lifestyle, it looks increasingly like your grandmother's lifestyle.
Doesn't it? Yeah. It's so cool. Well, Dr. Davis, it's always such a pleasure talking with you. What is the best place for people to find all of your books, your work, and whatever's coming next?
Well, Super Gut, of course, is the book that lays out all the microbes you can play with, where to get them, how to grow them. And they're delicious, too. You can make all kinds of crazy things with them. My website, which I consolidated into one big website called drdavisinfinitehealth.com. There's several thousand blog articles. There's a very busy forum with several hundred thousand posts, strings. And there's also, I do this two-way Zoom. We're getting about just under 100 people every Wednesday night for 2 hours. And we talk about these kinds of things. People say, my first batch yogurt didn't turn out. Why? But the great thing, Abel, is when we're collaborating together and asking similar questions and trying new things, the people who join our drdavisinfinitehealth.com inner circle, we learn new lessons all the time. We're learning new kinds of stuff from experts we bring on, yes, but also from the people, everyday people who say, I tried this and I experienced something new. We had a guy come on who said, he had this habit of twirling his hair and it had a big bald spot ever since he was 8 years old after he took a bunch of antibiotics. And it plagued him for years and years and years. They, of course, put him on antidepressants, sedatives, all kinds. Nothing worked. He always had this big bald spot. It was very embarrassing. And in his mid-40s, he made yogurt out of Bifidobacterium longum, a species of Bifidobacterium. He said it was remarkable. Within a couple of days, the impulse to pull his hair out stopped for the first time in his lifetime. So be true and 50 other people do it? Don't know. But you know what? We'll find out over time. So we're learning new things. It's kind of a platform of collaboration. So there's that also.
That's exactly what we need these days. The community, and also I know that people have gotten together and shared their starter for making your yogurts or your non-yogurt, whatever. They're sharing the strains person to person. And this also is very close to what our grandparents' generation probably did with sourdough starters and starters for fermenting veggies and pickles and all the rest of it. So it's really, if we all take advantage of it and team together, there are more health nuts out there than many of us probably realize. And now due to the nature of technology, we can do this really from wherever we are. And so that's very encouraging. And Dr. Davis, I'm so happy that you've created so many books, websites, and interviews, resources for people out there. And if you are listening, you haven't seen Dr. Davis's work, please read all of his books and everything that he has out there, because it's really, it's changed the trajectory of our lives. And it means so much to us to see you out there, Dr. Davis. Please keep going.
Well, you likewise, Abel. You, having done this for over 10 years, right? You're one of the original podcasters, and you're still at it. So I got to believe you've had a major impact on your own also. I encourage you to keep on doing it, and I'm here to help support you.
Right on. Thank you so much, Dr. Davis. I look forward to your next appearance on this show.
always a pleasure. Thanks, Abel.
Hey, it's Abel one last time, and I just want to say thank you for listening to this episode of Fat Burning Man. Before you go, please smash that like button, hit subscribe, or even leave us a quick review. It helps so much more than you even realize. And if you can think of someone else who you care about, friend, family member, anyone else who might appreciate this free show, then please take a quick second just to share it with them. Word of mouth is really the way that we've grown this show over the years. We have more than, at this point, 4 awards in independent media, 50 million downloads. We couldn't do any of this without you, so we really appreciate it. If you'd like to get in touch with me, then please follow me under Abel James or Fat Burning Man on your social media platform of choice, and I'll do my best to get right back to you. Now, if you want to keep this show coming to you, you can do something really quickly here. My wife Allison and I, along with a very small team, depend on listeners like you to make this show happen week after week. To join our next challenge, coaching group, or get in touch with me one-on-one, visit fatburningman.com. We also make group coaching free with your subscribe and save orders from our family company, Wild Superfoods, which you can find at wildsuperfoods.com. And if you'd like, you can throw a few bucks into the tip jar as a one-time donation or become a contributing member of our group on Patreon. Just look up Abel James on Patreon and you can join in the fun for as little as a few bucks and get my international best-selling book and audiobook as a special thanks. You can also find that page at fatburningman.com/tipjar. Now, a quick disclaimer for all those legal eagles out there. The Fat Burning Man Show provides general information and discussions about health and related subjects. The information provided in this show or in any related materials are not intended and should not be construed as medical advice, nor is the information a substitute for professional medical expertise, diagnosis, or treatment. The opinions and views expressed on this show have no relation to those of any academic, hospital, health practice, or other institution, including corporate overlords. We don't have any of those. If you or any other person has a medical concern, I wholeheartedly encourage you to consult with your healthcare provider. Whew! Okay. Don't forget to join our newsletter over at fatburningman.com. When you sign up for our email, I'll even send you a wild quick start guide along with a few of our ridiculously tasty recipes, even Allison's famous chocolate nut cookies, as a special thanks for signing up. This is Abel James signing off. Thank you so much for listening and have a great week.